गुड मॉर्निंग स्टूडेंट्स, मैं डॉक्टर प्रसन्ना जी पागा, एसोसिएट प्रोफेसर ENC डिपार्टमेंट, NMIT बैंगलोर। आई वेलकम यू ऑल टू दिस मीटिंग ई शिक्षण प्रोग्राम ऑन माइक्रोवेव एंड एंटीना, मॉड्यूल 3 लेक्चर 5। दीज आर द बेसिक कंटेंट दैट वी आर गोइंग टू कवर इन टूडेज क्लास। इट स्टार्ट्स विद इंट्रोडक्शन, वी विल टॉक अबाउट व्हाट इज एन एंटीना, what are the different parameters used for characterizing the antenna, how does the antenna radiate electromagnetic energy, then we will slowly look into the radiation pattern of the antenna. So radiation is playing a vital role in determining electric field and the field, and some important parameters on that. Then we will slowly move with the beam area, effective area over which in the power, then radiation intensity, efficiency, directivity, are the parameters that we are discussing in today's class, and we'll try to derive an empirical expression for each one of these parameters. Learning objectives: so here students will be able to understand the basic parameters characterizing the antenna and learn to plot the radiation pattern of the antenna. So basically here you are going to find out what are the different parameters involved in characterizing the antenna, to derive a mathematical expression for each one of these parameters, and also to try to results. That is very important. So you have problems on this. So this will be your use. Introduction. So whenever you talk about an antenna is a structure which is capable of converting a guided wave into a free space wave. I can say it's a structure which is converting a guided wave into a free space wave at the transmitter side, and the free space wave into a guided wave at the receiver side. So let us now look into the construction of the antenna. So this is the antenna that you see here. This is the transmitting antenna, this is the receiving antenna. So basically the generator is going to supply the voltage or current to a transmission line. This is a two wire transmission line. So this two wire transmission line is going to be tapered near the ends, and this is going to carry your signal from the generator to the antenna. So at this end you see that the antenna is going to be formed. This antenna is formed by open circuiting the two transmission lines. If the two wire transmission line is open circuited at the edge, it is going to behave as an antenna, okay, and it is going to radiate effectively provided the separation between the upper and the lower line approaches a value equal to λ/2. Okay, if this is done, then definitely it is going to radiate electromagnetic energy into free space. So normally you are going to apply a time varying voltage. So when a time varying voltage is applied to a two wire transmission line, you see that the modes are going to be excited. So normally the mode that is going to be excited is TEM mode, transfer wave. So this wave is also called as TEM wave. TEM wave is going to be propagated inside the RA transmission line. So again, this waveguide or transmission line is going to be tapered at the end. So normally when you apply a time varying voltage, as you can see, time varying voltages are going to radiate electromagnetic energy, which you have studied in the fields. Okay, so basically time varying voltages have to be applied for generating electric fields or magnetic fields to be radiated. So you apply time varying electric fields and magnetic fields. When such a time varying voltages or currents are applied across a transmission line, you see that the electric field lines will be reversing the polarity. So during one time they will be moving from upper line to the lower line, and when the AC voltage is negative, the electric field lines will move from the lower line to the upper line. So normally I can say there is a charge distribution which is going to be set up. So that means there will be a charge distribution. The upper end will be positive, the lower end will be negative. Okay, during the positive half cycle, again during the negative half cycle, this part will become positive, this part of the line will become negative. Okay, again this will be negative, this will be positive. So in other words, to say that there will be a interchange of the positive and negative charges which are going to be deposited on a transmission line, and this results due to the time varying voltages. When the AC voltage is positive, the upper line will be positive and the lower line will be negative, and when the AC voltage is negative, the lower line will be negative, the upper line will be positive. So this gives rise to electric fields. Normally electric fields originate on positive charges. So this is going to be on the transmission line. When it approaches near, that the field lines are going to be bent, and finally it is going to be at this particular point, I will say one dash, Okay, at this point you are open circuiting the lines such that this spacing, the spacing is approximately equal to lambda by 2. Okay, when the spacing approximately becomes equal to lambda by 2, you see that the electric fields are going to be formed into concentric circles, and these concentric circles or loops are going to be coming out in the form of a spherical wavefront, and which is finally radiated. Again, when these waves enter into the receiving antenna, you see that the receiving antenna is going to convert this wavefront, that is a plane wave, into a voltage or current. It is going to convert your electric field into electrical voltage or current, and again it is finally going to give it to the receiver. So this is your receiver. So receiver is basically a device which is going to take the power which is coming into the transmission line. So finally these antennas are meant to deliver power to some load. Okay, so you can see that the antenna is basically going to convert a plane wave into a free space wave, or I can say space wave, at the transmitter. At the receiver side, it is a plane wave into a guided wave. So here guided wave is a TEM wave, because TEM wave is going to be a dominant wave inside a two-wire transmission line. TEM stands for transverse electromagnetic wave, wherein electric field and magnetic field are perpendicular to each other and perpendicular to the direction of the propagation of the wave. The basic radiation equation governing the antenna is L di by dt is equal to Q dv by dt, where L represents the length of the current element, di by dt represents the time changing current, Q represents the charge on the current element, and dv by dt represents the acceleration of the charge, V represents the velocity of the charge. Okay, these charges are going to be accelerated when they are going to be moving along the two wire transmission line. So in other words, I will say that for an antenna to radiate an electromagnetic energy into free space, you should have a time changing current. That means if a time changing current is going to be set up across a length of the conductor, then it is going to radiate electromagnetic energy, or an accelerating charge which is going to be deposited on the two wire transmission line, that can be radiated into free space, provided the transmission line is going to be open circuited. Okay, so this equation is going to be holding good as long as the transmission line is going to be tapered and open circuited at the receiving, at the end, at the receiving, at the final stage, you can say. So basically I can say a guided transmission line which opens out will radiate electromagnetic energy into free space, and normally this guided wave is a plane wave, while the radiated wave is a spherically expanded wave. Okay, that you should understand the difference between a guided wave and a spherically expanded wave. Normally, the transmission line will be in the form, that means it is going to have a spherical sphere. Okay, so at the receiving end, the antenna is going to convert this free space wave into a guided wave, and is finally going to come out of the antenna. So from a circuit point of view, the antenna appears as a fixture resistance called as the radiation resistance. So this is the transmitter, this is the transmission line, this is the transmission line, this transmission line is going to this direction, and it is finally tapered at the edges. So this is your radiation resistance RR, which is nothing but the fixture resistance. So from the circuit point of view, the antenna to the transmission line as a resistance RR, okay, that the antenna is going to be appearing as though it is going to be radiation resistance RR, which is called as the fixture. All the power appears to be coming out when it is transmitting electromagnetic energy, or all the power appears to be coming into the antenna whenever it is acting as a receiving antenna. So it is through this radiation resistance only that the power is going to be either coming out of the antenna or coming into the antenna. The next is radiation pattern. So radiation pattern is a graphical representation of electric and magnetic field as a function of angle theta and phi. It's called as the radiation pattern of the antenna. So you have a transmitting antenna, which will be normally a horn antenna. You have a receiving antenna, which will be in the far field. Antenna is going to be excited with 1 watt of power, and the transmitter and the receiver should be operating at the same frequency. Then rotated. So you rotate the receiving antenna in azimuth plane as well as along the elevation plane for different values of theta and phi. Okay, so distribution of the electric field you are going to get, you are going on the resultant pattern. Again, is of plotting the radiation pattern of the antenna. So one is you need the theta component of the electric field as a function of angle theta and phi, which we call it as E theta of theta comma phi. Next, you need the phi component of electric field as a function of angle theta and phi, which you call it as E phi of theta comma phi. And finally, the phase of these fields as a function of angle theta and phi, that you call it as delta theta of theta comma phi. So all these three things are plotting the radiation pattern of the antenna. Methods of representing the radiation pattern of the antenna. There are three different ways of representing the radiation pattern of the antenna. One is the field pattern, the power pattern, and the dB pattern. So whenever I say field pattern, the field pattern represents the variation of the electric field and magnetic field as a function of angle theta and phi. That you call it as field pattern. So for plotting the field pattern, you rotate the antenna in both the azimuth plane as well as the elevation plane. Then you have got the power pattern. So power pattern represents a plot of the normalized power, okay, as a function of angle theta and phi. That is the power pattern. So normally, whenever you square the electric field pattern, that is called as the power pattern. Another important pattern is, so dB pattern is obtained by taking the logarithmic scale of the normalized power. When you take 10 log to the base 10 p, this is the normalized power, and if you plot it as a function of angle theta and phi, then you call it as the so normally the y-axis is going to, the vertical axis is going to represent the power level in dB, and the horizontal axis is going to be representing the angles in degrees. So right hand side will be clockwise and left hand side will be anti-clockwise. So this is the radiation pattern of the antenna. As you can see, the radiation pattern of the antenna has got three important points on it. Okay, one is known as the main lobe, the side lobes, and the back lobes. These are the three important points. This is known as the main lobe. So these are the side lobes and these are the back lobes. So between the main lobe and the side lobe, you have a null. Okay, you have a null here, you have a null here. Null represents the point at which the electric field intensity is zero. Okay, that is known as the null. To represent any point P on the radiation pattern of the antenna, you need three things. One is the theta component of the electric field, which you call it as E theta. The phi component of the electric field, which you call it as E phi, and the third important parameter is the power. So the power flow is going to be essentially radial. Okay, so you have all these three things. You have E theta and E phi. That means the electric field and magnetic fields are going to be perpendicular to each other and perpendicular to the direction of the propagation. Okay, so this is your direction of the propagation. So these are the side lobes. Side lobes represent the unwanted lobes. Okay. Or wastage of power, these are known as the back lobes. Back lobes are going to be found whenever the antenna receives power due to reflections from the side walls. So back lobes are going to be formed. So again, you have nulls in between. Okay, so this is known as the three dimensional radiation pattern of the antenna. So you can see it has got main lobe, side lobes, and back lobes. So now let us try to look into the two dimensional pattern. So this is your two dimensional pattern. So normally what you do is you take the electric field and if you plot this electric field, okay, by rotating the receiving antenna in either clockwise or anti-clockwise direction, the electric field intensity goes on changing. Okay, when the antenna, transmitting antenna and receiving antenna are facing each other, you get maximum value, which you call it as the Bohr side direction. That is going to be obtained for theta is equal to zero. And when you rotate this receiving antenna in either clockwise or anti-clockwise, the electric field intensity goes on decreasing. Okay, and at this particular point, you see the electric field intensity will be 0.707 times. That means the energy contained in this angular value is called as the half power bandwidth. Okay, which represents the useful power radiated by the antenna. So in this case, the half power bandwidth is 40 degree. That means your antenna pattern is symmetrical, both on clockwise as well as along the anti-clockwise direction. So if I say this is 20 degree, this will be minus 20 degree. So half power bandwidth will be 40 degree. And again, if I rotate the receiving antenna further by keeping the transmitting antenna fixed, you see that the electric field intensity further decreases and becomes equal to zero. Okay. So this point represents the null. If I draw a tangent at this particular point on the radiation pattern, it is going to represent a null. Null represents the point at which the electric field intensity is zero. signal you are going to get when you rotate the receiving antenna direction. So the in between the two null beam width, and this also represents the area, angular area over which the main lobe is extended or main beam is extended. Main beam of the antenna is going to be extended. Again, further, if you rotate the receiving antenna, so you see that there will be a side lobes, okay, wherein the electric field becomes slightly, where electric field slightly increases, again decreases. Again, further, you rotate the receiving antenna, again it increases, decreases, increases, decreases. So this process is going to continue. Okay, so these are known as the side lobes and the back lobes. So a pattern obtained by normalized component of electric field at theta and phi is called as the field pattern. And the third, the another important pattern is the power pattern. So power pattern, if you take power, power is equal to what? Square of the electric field. I think you know power is given by what? Pointing vector. So what is pointing vector? Pointing vector is equal to P. Okay, if I say P is the power, power is equal to, power is related to field with this pointing vector E cross H. Okay, E is known as the electric field and H is known as the magnetic field. Okay, what is E cross H? E cross H is EH sin theta. So normally E and H are going to be subtending an angle of theta is equal to 90 degree. Okay, if theta is equal to 90 degree, okay, so what you get? EH sin theta, EH sin theta, isn't it? EH sin theta, sin theta. So sin theta will be, theta is equal to 90 degree if you put, it will be what? P is equal to E into H. P is equal to E to H because theta is equal to 90 degrees, sin 90 will be equal to 1. So H will be equal to what? H will be, again E and H are going to be related with this equation. Okay, you should understand that electric field and magnetic fields are going to be related with the intrinsic impedance of the free space. Okay, to find out the intrinsic impedance of the free space, so what you do is, you can just use equation E theta by H phi. Okay, in the far field E by H is always equal to 125. Okay, this is also called as eta naught. Intrinsic impedance of the free space. Okay. If you look at this, then what you get is equal to, so then we can write H as equal to E by 125. So P will be equal to E square by 125. P is equal to E square by 125. So this is what you are going to get. This is the power radiated by the antenna, okay, which is equal to E square by 125. So if I say 125 is a constant, so P is approximately, P is proportional to E square. Okay. So P is proportional to modulus of electric field intensity whole square. Okay. So that means to say that if I square this electric field pattern, the normalized electric field pattern, and again plot it as a function of angle theta and phi, then you are going to get the power pattern. Again, on the power pattern, you see that the maximum value will be 1. Okay. And when you square this pattern, the pattern is going to shrink, okay, in size. Okay, this point represents the half power beamwidth, is half the maximum. If you look at this particular here, this point is also 0.5p. Okay. So the angular value, the energy contained in this angular value is approximately half the power. So that's why it's called as half power beam width. And again, when you further rotate the receiving antenna, you see that the power level becomes equal to 0. So that point represents the occurrence of a null. So this will be your first null. Side, since the antenna pattern is symmetrical on the in the anti-clockwise direction, energy contained or the power contained in between the is called as the first null beam width. Okay, that represents the angular area over which the main lobe is going to be present. Okay, so the main lobe is going to be present for this particular angular value. Okay, that is known as the it is also part of the demarking point between the main lobe and the side lobe. So after this null only you get the side lobes here. So you get first side lobe, second side lobe, third side lobe, and as well as you get the back lobes. So this is about the power pattern. The next important pattern is part of the DB pattern. So DB pattern is represented here. If I take 10 log to the base 10, so I think you see the you have seen the power pattern. If I take 10 log to the base 10 of, okay, Pn of theta comma phi. If I take 10 log to the base 10, Pn of theta comma phi. Then you are going to get the DB pattern, okay, which is representing the power level in DB. In DB, okay. Or I can say power level in DB. I can write this as P in DB. So P in DB is given by 10 log to the base 10 Pn of theta comma phi. So normally if the value of Pn of theta comma phi is equal to 1, so 10 log 1 will be equal to 0 dB. Log 1 will be equal to 0. Log to the base 10 1 is equal to 0. Okay, 0 multiplied with the 10. So this is going to be E. Next, there is another point which is known as the half power point. So half power point is this point. So in this point, I told you, if you look at the normalized power pattern, at this point power value is equal to how much? Half the maximum, isn't it? Here also it is half, and here also it is going to be half. Okay, if I take 10 log to the base 10 of half, so what do I get? So I will do one thing, I will find out the value half point, half power. Okay, let's substitute Pn of theta. Okay. So is equal to 10 log to the base 10 half. So 10 log to the base 10 half is equal to, I can write this as log 1 minus log 2, log 2 is 0.3010 into 10 is equal to minus 3 dB. So this is minus 3.0 dB. So this represents the 3 dB point here, which you see here. On the dB scale, it will be minus 3 dB, and the power contained in between the two angular values, if I draw two vertical lines, okay, if I draw two vertical lines here, okay, and if I extend it on the theta axis, again here also if I extend it, so this power contained in this angular width is called as the half power beam width, which is represented here. In this case, if it is 40 degree, means this side it will be 20 degree for this case, and this side it will be minus 20 degree. 20 plus 20 will be equal to 40. Again, when you decrease the, rotate the receiving antenna, you see that the power level goes on decreasing. And at this particular point, you see that the power level will become some large negative. Here it has become somewhere around minus 30 degree. Okay, if I take a laser pointer, you can understand. So here it has become minus 40 dB, and here also it has become minus 40 dB, around minus 40 dB. Okay, so a large negative value represents a null. Okay, so this null, the angular value, this angular value will be, let us say, 37 degree and minus 37 degree. Okay, for this case. So then the angular value contained will be 74 degree. Okay, this power contained in this angular width is called as the full null beam width, and it represents the extension of the main lobe of the antenna. Okay, in the azimuth plane or in the elevation plane. So after that, you see that again when the receiving antenna is rotated, you see that there will be a side lobe and a back lobe. This will be your first side lobe level, which is minus 9 dB. It is shown here. This is the first side lobe level. Second side lobe level is minus 13 dB. Okay, that means the side lobe level goes on decreasing. Okay, and this side represents the back lobes. This is your back lobe. So this is obtained when the antenna is oriented exactly 180 degree with respect to your transmitting antenna. When the receiving antenna is 180 degree with respect to your transmitting antenna, then there will be reflection. That reflections will be captured by the antenna, because this will be facing this side, this transmitting antenna will be facing this side. So it is going to capture the radiations coming out from the reflections due to walls and other objects, and this point represents the back lobes. So this is normally the side lobe should be below minus 20 dB. That's what they say. First side lobe, second side lobe, and multiple side lobes should be below minus 20 dB. Then only the antenna is going to be treated as an effective antenna, because these side lobes are going to represent the wastage of power. Okay, so we have to minimize the power loss. So to minimize the power loss, we need to minimize the side lobe levels. So that is very, very important if I want to design a very good antenna. So radiation pattern lobes. So now let us try to summarize that. So a major lobe is defined as the radiation lobe containing the direction of maximum radiation. Hence, there is a minor lobe. The minor lobe represents wastage of power, and it also represents going in the undesired directions. Okay. So side lobes are the largest of the minor lobes. And a side lobe can also be defined as a lobe in any direction other than the intended lobe. That means the one which is going to be radiating in the undesired direction, that is known as the side lobe. Then you have a back lobe. A back lobe is a radiation lobe whose axis makes an angle of approximately 180 degree with respect to the beam of the antenna. That is known as the back lobe. Next is beam area. So beam area, whenever I said, beam area represents the effective angular area over which the antenna is radiating the power. Okay, effective angular area over which the antenna is radiating the power. That is also called as the useful power. Okay, that is known as the beam area. Another way of defining the beam area is, it is the solid angle through which the power radiated by the antenna would stream if P of theta comma phi maintained its maximum value over omega A. Obviously, P of theta comma phi value will be maximum in the half power region. So that is known as the beam area. So now let us look into the mathematical expression for beam area. Let us try to derive a mathematical expression for that. Let us consider the antenna at the center. Okay, this antenna is going to be treated as an isotropic antenna, which is radiating power uniformly in all the directions. So I will say this is the point P on the radiation pattern of the antenna. Okay, this point P is going to be resolved. Now let us try to create a small area dA. Okay, now if I say this is z-axis, this is the elevation plane, this is your azimuth plane. Okay, if I am taking some small piece of area on the radiation pattern, okay, I am going to call this as dA. That is the differential area, dA. Okay, area of this small differential strip. To find out that, what we do is z-axis radius of the sphere. If I say r is the radius of the sphere, so this will be your r. This r will be constant from here to here or anywhere around the sphere. This is r, same r here also. So if this is r, and if I say this angle is theta, okay, which the strip is subtending with respect to the center of the sphere where your antenna is positioned. Okay, so then this adjacent point component is given by r cos theta. This is your r cos theta. Okay, and the elevation component is given by r sin theta. This opposite component is given by the r sin theta, and this angle is d phi. As you all know, this is, if I say this is phi, this will be d phi. So this total angular value is phi plus d phi. This is phi plus d phi. and this total angular value is theta plus d theta. Theta plus. Okay, so now the in the elevation plane depending from theta plus theta. This is theta. Okay, theta plus d theta minus theta will be equal to d theta. Okay, this is the extension along the elevation plane, extension of the strip along the elevation plane, and extension of the strip along the azimuth plane is given by 5 plus d5 minus this is this end of the strip, this end of the strip is going to subtend an angle equal to 5. So the total angular separation in azimuth plane is 5 plus d5 minus 5. Okay. So this will be giving me d5. So this angle, this width of the strip is given by r sin theta into d5, this angular width, and along the elevation plane it is r d theta. Okay, because this length is r everywhere, so the angular value contained in this part is d theta, so r into d theta gives me the height of the strip. So the width of the strip, height of the strip, area of the strip is given by r sin theta d5 into r d theta, which is comes out to be equal to r square sin theta d theta d5. Okay, and again the sin theta d theta d phi is called as the differential solid angle, okay, which is given by d omega. So this d omega is the differential solid angle subtended at the center of the sphere with respect to the differential area dA. Okay, that means the differential area is going to subtend an angular equal to d omega at the center of the strip. Okay, so I can write this as r square d omega, where d omega is sin theta d theta d phi. Now what we will do is to find out the, that means I can say the strip area dA is going to subtend a differential angle equal to d omega. Now I am interested in finding out how many such solid angles are going to be present in a radiation pattern, okay, which is going to be resembling to that of a sphere. Sphere means it is isotropic radiation pattern. I want to find out how many such solid angles are there inside that. To do that, what we will do is we will take this dA. dA is equal to r square sin theta d theta d phi, which is r square d omega. We will move this strip from theta is equal to 0 to theta is equal to pi. So first what we will do is we will take this strip, you take this strip, multiply it with 2 pi into r square d phi. This will be your total strip. Okay, strip 2 pi r square sin theta d phi, sin theta 2 pi r square sin theta d theta d phi. You move this strip from theta is equal to 0 to theta is equal to pi. Okay, you move from here to here, entire 180 degree along the theta plane. So if you integrate it, you will get the total solid angle. So to do that, what we are doing is area of the sphere is equal to 2 pi r square into integral theta is equal to 0 to pi sin theta d theta. So this will be 2 pi r square integral of sin theta is minus cos theta, with theta varying from 0 to pi. If you substitute, it will be cos pi minus cos 0, which will be 4 pi r square. So 4 pi r square is the area of the sphere. So again, if you look at dA is equal to r square d omega, so when you integrate it, the total area becomes equal to A, then d omega becomes equal to 4 pi. Okay, so this d omega is nothing but your omega, which is equal to 4 pi. So there are 4 pi steradians which are going to be contained inside the radiation pattern of the antenna, which is going to be isotropic. It is resembling to that of a sphere. Now let us try to convert this steradians into square degrees. So solid angle is normally expressed in steradians. To convert into square degrees, what we do is we use the conversion factor. So one steradian is equal to approximately 1 radian square. Okay. So 1 radian square means it is equal to again 180 by pi degrees. Okay, so radian square means 180 by pi whole square into degree square. So if I use that equation, it comes out to be equal to approximately 3282.8064 square degrees. So these many square degrees are going to be contained in one steradian. Okay, one steradian 0.8064 square. Now let us try to find out how these are there in the 4 pi steradians. Multiply this with 4 pi into 3282.8064. So when you multiply it, you will get 41,253 square degrees. So these many square degrees are going to be contained inside a sphere. Now to find out the beam area of the antenna, what we do is we take the normalized power. We have the radiation pattern of the antenna. Okay, we have the radiation pattern of the antenna. Okay, on the radiation pattern of the antenna, okay, you will integrate it So this is your I say this is Pn of theta comma phi. The normalized power, you take the power pattern and you try to integrate this power pattern. If I say this is x, this is y, this is z, you integrate this power pattern from theta is equal to 0 to pi, this is theta is equal to 0. This is pi. To integrate it from theta is equal to 0 to pi, pi is 0 to pi, from here to here, and pi is equal to 0 to 2 pi, Pn of theta comma pi d omega. So when you do this, you get the beam area of the antenna. So beam area again d omega can be written as sin theta d theta d phi. Already know this. So substitute that. So omega a, which is the total beam area, is integral theta is equal to 0 to pi, integral pi is equal to 0 to pi, Pn of theta comma pi, sin theta d theta d phi. So if you integrate it, you get the beam area of the antenna. So this is for a hypothetical antenna. Okay, so practical antenna, if you look at, so practical antenna has got, let us say this is your radiation pattern of the practical antenna. Okay, so for a practical antenna, this will be your Pn of theta comma phi, let us say. This is your Pn of theta comma phi or E of theta comma phi, no problem, your power pattern. Okay, so if it is point find out the angular value contained, the angular value contained in the half power points, the angular, the energy contained in the half power points, you find out that. So this value, find out the theta 1 and the theta 2 of this. So this angular value is going to represent theta hp. So theta hp represents the power, useful power contained in the half power. That is another theta hp. This is in the elevation plane. Again, when you plot the radiation pattern in the azimuth plane, that is in the horizontal plane, then again you find out the half power beamwidth. So where the power level is half the maximum. Okay, our field level is 0.707 times the maximum. So both are accepted. Again, the energy contained in this angular region, that you call it as phi hp, which is in the azimuth plane, multiply theta hp into phi hp, that is going to give you roughly the beam area of the antenna. Okay, that is the beam area of the antenna. So theta hp into phi hp represents the beam area for a practical antenna. Next is radiation intensity. So what is radiation intensity? As I have told you, T is the power radiated by an antenna. See, you see, antenna power, okay, it is going on changing, okay, depending on where, in the case of a sun, when you are standing during morning, the radiation, you know, again in the afternoon intensity will be maximum, again in the evening time, again you see that the intensity of the sunlight will become lesser and lesser. So in the same way, intensity means how much sunlight you are receiving per unit area or per unit cross section your body is going to receive. Okay, here radiation intensity is defined as the power radiated by the antenna per unit solid angle. Okay, that is known as the radiation intensity. Let us take, for example, a three-dimensional coordinate system. Okay, if you take a three-dimensional coordinate system, PD represents the power transmitted, 4 pi r square represents the surface area of the sphere. Okay, so if just I think we have seen that the differential area dA is going to then some differential solid angle d omega. Okay, so per d omega, per unit solid angle, per one steradian, how much power is going to be coming out from the antenna, or how much power is radiated by that antenna, is given by the radiation intensity. So now you take the pointing vector or power density, which is given by Pt divided by 4 pi r square, where Pt represents the power transmitted, 4 pi r square represents the surface area of the sphere, Sr represents the radial component of the pointing vector or power density, Pt represents the transmitted power, R represents the distance between the antenna and the field. So if you compare it to the LHS, so R equal to Pt by 4 pi, this is equal to, this is known as the radiation intensity. It is also represented by U of theta comma phi. So this represents the power per unit solid angle. Again, what you can do is, it is expressed in watts per steradian. If I want to have a normalized power, I can have the normalized power expressed in terms of either power density or radiation intensity. In terms of radiation intensity, is given by radiation intensity for any arbitrary value of theta comma phi, you get a maximum radiation intensity which you get when theta and phi are zero. When the transmitting antenna is going to be facing the receiving antenna, the radiation intensity will be maximum. So same thing, the it is also given by the ratio of the S of theta comma phi. That means the pointing vector for any arbitrary value of theta comma phi divided by maximum pointing vector or maximum power density. Power density by maximum power density is given to you the normalized power, okay, that the antenna is going to radiate. Next important thing is beam efficiency. So beam efficiency is a parameter which is going to tell in which direction the antenna is going to radiate more power and in which direction the antenna is going to radiate less power. Or in other words, I can say it represents the ratio of the useful power to the total power in terms of angular values. Okay, so if you consider the radiation pattern of the antenna, here I am considering the radiation pattern of the antenna. Okay, this is the field pattern. You see here the field is maximum and having a value equal to 1. Here the field is 0.707 times the maximum. Here the field is going to become 0. Then you have got side lobes and back lobes. Okay, so beam efficiency is defined as the ratio of beam area to the total beam area, omega omega a, where omega capital M represents the mean equal to the sum of which is nothing but the mean, and small m represents the minor. Look at the radiation pattern. Okay, so normally this is equal to omega m1. Okay, I will say this is omega m1. Okay, this is omega m2. This is omega m3. This is omega m4. If you add all these beam areas, this is omega m4. So if I say this area is omega m1, omega capital M, omega capital M is this area, main beam area. This is the total beam area which includes the side lobes and the back lobes. It is given by the ratio of the main beam area to the total beam area. So where main beam area is represented by omega m and beam minor lobe area omega m is given by the sum of omega m1, it is equal to omega m1 plus omega m2 omega m3 plus omega m4 continues. Okay, so the total area is nothing but omega m. Another important parameter is what are the stray factors. Power radiated by the antenna in the, okay, which is lobes and the back lobes. Power contained in the side lobes and the back lobes to the total power radiated in terms of angular values we are talking. Okay, so that is what is given by omega small m divided by omega capital A, where omega capital A represents the total beam area, which is sum of the main lobe and the side lobes. So again, this epsilon small m is one of the stray factor. So it follows that the sum of beam efficiency and stray factor is always equal to 1. Directivity. So directivity of an antenna is defined as the ratio of the maximum radiation intensity to the average radiation intensity radiated over a sphere. Okay. It can also be represented in terms of the ratio of the maximum to the average pointing vector or maximum radiation intensity to the average radiation intensity. That also again represents the directivity. So directivity is calculated by using this formula. So first find out the S of theta comma phi average. That means the average pointing vector or power density, which is given by 1 by 4 pi integral theta is equal to 0 to pi integral phi is equal to 0 to 2 pi S of theta comma phi d omega. First find out that it is going to give you the average power density. Then again, directivity is given by S of theta comma phi. I told you directivity is S of theta comma phi max divided by S of theta comma phi average, isn't it? This is S of theta comma phi max divided by S of I average. Okay, so for S of theta comma phi, substitute this equation. S of theta comma phi average. S of theta comma to this equation. So you are going to get this 1 by 4 pi integral theta is equal to 0 to pi integral phi is equal to 0 to 2 pi s of theta comma phi d omega. Okay, max will be the numerator. So again take this term to the denominator. So it will become s of theta comma phi divided by s of theta comma phi max d omega is equal to what? Sin theta d theta d phi. Okay, so substitute that value here. Again, if you simplify it, okay, this becomes s of theta comma phi max s of theta comma phi divided by s of theta comma phi as the normalized power which we saw here just now. So this is normalized power Pn of theta comma phi, and this sin theta d theta d phi is again d omega. Theta is equal to 0 to pi, integral phi is equal to 0 to 2 pi. So this is actually going to represent your beam area. Okay, and you take this 4 pi to the numerator. Okay, if we take 4 pi to the numerator, this portion is going to represent your beam area of the antenna. Okay, which is your omega a. Okay. So this 4 pi will be the numerator, so approximately given by 4 pi by omega a. Okay, again this 4 pi is nothing but, again you can convert this into square degrees, and omega a you can again find out approximately for a practical antenna, which is given by the product of the half power beam widths in the two principal planes, that is theta plane and phi plane. You see this is theta hp into phi hp, and 4 pi you multiply it with 3280. You get 41,253 divided by 5 HP. So this is directivity. I say once the radian radians square. Once the radian is always equal to, okay. So again it is equal to 180 by 5 whole square. So this comes out to be 3282.8064 or directivity 41,253 divided by HP. Another important parameter. So whenever you call the gain of the antenna, it is defined as the product efficiency into directivity. So mathematically G is equal to K into D. Known as the antenna efficiency factor. Efficiency factor is normally going to be taken in between 0.65 to 0.7. Okay. Normally they take 0.6. Okay. 0.65. So let us say 0.7. Okay, it depends on the type of the antenna. Okay. This efficiency represents the loss that is taking place. There is a loss, okay, which is taking place inside the antenna. There will be loss on the radiating structure. There will be power loss on the radiating structure. There is on the metal part. There will be loss inside the dielectric if you are talking about and all. So in that case, whatever power I have transmitted, the entire power is not going to be radiated. Loss, because of the loss and efficiency factor involved, that efficiency factor is definitely going to put a limitation on the gain. So I can say that the efficiency will not be 100%. Okay, so always gain will be less than equal to direct, less than or equal to gain will be always less than the directivity of the antenna. So again, another way of finding the gain is you can try to find out the it is the ratio of the maximum power density of the antenna under test. Okay, and again what you can do is this, you can take down the maximum power density of the reference antenna. This can be your reference antenna. Okay, so reference antenna will be a dipole antenna. So that dipole antenna, you know already the power density of that. Take that reference antenna, that is dipole antenna, and again multiply it with the gain of the reference antenna, which is dipole antenna. So normally gain of the reference antenna will be known to you, 1. So again, if you find it is gain is a relative thing, is you are trying to compare your antenna under test with the antenna known to you. If I say the gain of patch antenna is 5 dB. Or let us say if the batch gain of the patch antenna is, let us say, 100, that means it is having 100, it is radiating 100 times more compared to a dipole antenna. Okay, because dipole antenna gain is 1. So gain is a relative quantity. All the time you are comparing the gain of the antenna under test with the reference antenna. So if I say for some antenna I got 30 as the gain, then it is radiating 30 times more efficiently compared to the unity gain antenna, that is a dipole antenna. Now let us do some problems on the antenna part. Okay, and first let us do first problem. An antenna has a radiation resistance of 73 ohm and a loss resistance of 7 ohm. If the power gain is 20, calculate the directivity and efficiency of the antenna. So I can say you need to find out gain and directivity. I told you gain is related to directivity by antenna efficiency. Antenna efficiency mathematically it is having a value, numerically a value equal to 0.65 to 0.7. It depends, depending on the type of the antenna. Antenna efficiency is also given by the ratio of the effective aperture to the maximum effective aperture. Okay, now effective aperture is given by V squared delta 4S RR plus RL. This you are going to study in the next chapter, wherein we will talk about the aperture concept there. There will try to model the antenna and will try to derive an expression for this AE and AEM. So for now, AE is given by V squared delta 4S RR plus RL, where RR is the radiation resistance of the antenna, RL is the loss resistance of the antenna, V is the induced voltage, S is the power density. Okay, so you try to find out this. And AEM is given by whenever you try to match the antenna at a maximum power transfer condition, maximum power transfer condition, wherein you do matching and you transmit the power to the antenna and neglect the loss resistance RL. Make this RL is equal to zero. Under that condition, you get the maximum effective aperture. So that is given by V squared divided by 4S RR, where RR represents the radiation resistance of the antenna, which we discussed. So if you substitute this in the expression for antenna efficiency, it comes out to be equal to RR divided by RR plus RL. Okay, so because V square cancels out, have RR divided by RR plus RL. So again, you write the value of RR. RR is going to use 73 ohm. RL is 7 ohm. So substitute this, you get 73 by 80, which is equal to 0.9125. This is the antenna efficiency. Gain is neta. Our directivity is gain by neta. 0.9125. Gain is going to be 0.9125. So it is 21.915. It is going to be approximately equal to 21.9915, or in terms of dBs, you can take 10 log to the base 10 of 21.9125, it will get 13.407 dB. Next, let us try to do another problem. An antenna has a field pattern given by E of theta is equal to cos square theta, where theta is going to be varied from 0 determine the half power beam width, and for this you can plot the pattern. To look at the pattern, E of theta is equal to cos square theta, you can take this. And if you plot the pattern, it will be looking like this. Okay, this is your half power beam width. Okay, you have this side also, as well as you have on this side also. On both the sides, you are having this half power. So this side will be 0.707. Okay, this side also will be 0.707. This is, I am talking about field pattern. This is having a value equal to 1. This will be 1.0. This is the pattern of, this is theta is equal to 0. Okay. So they have given E of theta is equal to cos square theta. This is cos square theta pattern. Okay, so when you plot out two things. One is we need to find out what is the half power beam width, HPBW. And another important thing. Okay, so beam area of the antenna, both are to be found out. Now for E theta is equal to cos square theta, between theta is equal to 0 to theta is equal to 90 degree. So E of theta at half power will be approximately equal to 0.707. So cos square theta you equate it to 0.707. You get cos theta is equal to root of 0.707. So if you take the inverse of this, so theta you get it as equal to 33 degree. So this is one theta you get it only on this side. Okay. If I say this is your radiation pattern. Okay, you get only one theta this side. Okay. So theta is there on this side also as well. Okay. So this value will be 2 into 33, so it will be approximately equal to 63. Okay, this will be theta again. So this will be 2 theta, 2 theta will be 66 degree. So total half power beam width will be 66 degree. Now let us try to find out the beam area. So how do you find out the beam area? Means if you integrate this normalized power Pn of theta comma phi, okay, over the entire radiation pattern of the antenna, then you are going to get the beam. To find out Pn of theta comma phi, you have E of theta is equal, okay, E is equal to cos square theta, which is given to you. Okay, so what you can do is you can find out the, I told you the P is given by what? P is proportional to the P square. So we are going to do that. So P is equal to modulus of E of theta whole square. So it will be cos to the power of 4 theta. And integrate this. Okay. So omega A is given by double integral Pn of theta comma phi d omega, isn't it? Pn of theta comma phi d omega. Okay, this is theta is equal to 0 to pi. Phi is equal to 0 to 2 pi. Theta. So if you integrate it, okay, so theta will be from 0 to pi by 2, phi will be along the entire azimuth plane, that is 0 to 2 pi. So E of theta whole square, because power is square of theta, okay, d omega is nothing but sine theta d theta d phi. Sin theta d theta d phi, that d phi we have taken here. So this comes out to be equal to 2 pi, and cos square theta whole square is cos to the power of 4 theta into sin theta d theta, integrated from theta is equal to 0 to pi by 2. For that, what you can do is you can take cos theta is equal to t minus sin theta d theta will be, this is what we have done here. Then theta is equal, put it here, t will be equal to 1, and theta t will be equal to 0, so omega a will be equal to minus 2 pi into integral from 1 to 0 t to the power of 4 equal to 2 pi into 1 t to the power of 4. This will be 2 t to the power of 2 pi into t to the power of 0 to 1, so this will be 2 pi, and this will be 2 pi by 5 steradian. This is approximately 0.26 steradians. So this is the beam area of the antenna. Okay, so we can also verify this, okay, using the approximate formula. What was our approximate formula? Omega A is equal to theta HP into pi HP, isn't it? This was our approximate formula, theta HP into pi HP. So we already found out the theta HP and the pi HP. Okay, so we found out theta HP, we can again replicate it on the, then also it will be same. So you can take theta HP as 66 degree. Okay, since antenna pattern is symmetrical, more or less this also will be having a value equal to 66 degree. So substitute that, 66 square will be equal to 4356 square degrees. Again, if you normalize it with respect to 32.8064, you get 1.33 steradians. So this is your beam area, approximate beam area, using the formula, this one. Okay. And this is your beam area value with the formula that we have discussed. Okay. It is double integral Pn of theta gamma phi d omega. Using that, you get 1.26 steradians. Using the product of theta hp and phi hp, you get 1.33 steradians. So error margin is very small. Okay, so I can say that approximately both the results are going to be matching here. Next, let us try to do second problem, third problem. Compute the value of solid angle in square degrees in the case of a spherical surface of radius r meters between the elevation angles of theta is equal to 20 degree and theta is equal to 40 degree, and azimuth angles of phi is equal to 30 degree and phi is equal to 70 degree. So they have given this value and phi by from 30 to 70 value 30 to 70. This is your area. This is your area. Okay, you have to find out the number of solid angles contained in this area with respect to the center of the sphere. Here there will be your sphere. Okay. What is the total solid angles contained here? So total number of angular values contained in this is given by integral of phi is equal to 30 to phi, theta is equal to 20 to theta is equal to 40. This is theta is equal to 20 to 40, phi is equal to 30 to 70. So we have substitute here, phi is equal to 30 to 70, 20 to 40, d phi will be sin theta d theta. Again, if you integrate, convert this into radians also, okay, so 30 degrees corresponds to pi by 6. Again, 70 degrees also converted into radians. Very simple. Pi radians is equal to 180 degrees, isn't it? Pi radians is equal to 180 degrees. Okay, 1 radian is equal to 180 by pi. And convert this. And you can try to convert that into radians. You get pi by 6 to 7 pi by 18. This will be 1 pi by 9 to 2 pi by 9. This will be sin theta d theta. So again, if you find out, this will be 1 to steradians. So you will get the answer directly in steradians. So you can convert into degrees. You get 0.3282.8064. This will be 397 square degrees. Let us do the last problem. An antenna has a field pattern given by E of theta is equal to cos theta into cos 2 theta. This is the pattern where theta is equal to greater than 0 but less than, determine the half power beam width. So again, if you plot the pattern, this is how it looks. At half power, this value, this is a field pattern. So field pattern means at this point, let us say it is 0.707. Okay, and again at this point also it is 0.707. Okay. So this is not 41 degree, just for your understanding. So we have to find out. So field pattern becomes at half be equal to 0.707 times maximum. So cos theta into cos 2 theta is factor that you equate it. So cos 2 theta is 2 cos square into cos theta. This will be equal to 1 by root 2. So again, this will become, when you expand it, it will be 2 cos cube theta minus cos theta is equal to 1 by root 2. Again, when you simplify this, this x value becomes equal to 0.9236. So cos theta value will be equal to theta is equal to cos inverse of 0.936, which will be 20.5 degree, or half power beam width is approximately equal to 41 degree, or beam width between both persons is 82 degree. Let us take a small quiz. With an increase in the beam area of the antenna, the computed directivity increases, decreases, remains unchanged, none of the above. So these are the four options given. I told you directivity is inversely related to beam area. So omega A, as the beam area of the directivity decreases, this answer is B. Next question is, the sum of beam efficiency and stray factor is always 1 equal to 1, greater than 1, none of them mentioned. I told you sum of the beam efficiency and stray factor is always equal to. So again, in this case, the option is B. your question for an antenna that radiates over only a half sphere, the numerical value of directivity is A 1 4, option C 2, option D. Just think about it. The antenna is hemispherical, is radiating power only in the upper hemisphere, and it is radiating no power in the lower hemisphere. So then in that case, the total solid angle will be 2 pi instead of 4 pi. So omega I will be 2 pi. 4 pi by 2 pi will be equal to 2. So the directivity value is equal to 2. Which if an antenna has a half power beamwidth of principal planes, its directivity in dB 40, 20, 100. Again, the directivity is given by 41,250 HP to 5 HP. Substitute that value, you get 103. Take 10 log to the base 10 of 103, you get 20 dBA. So answer is option C, 20. So to summarize, the different parameters of the antenna. First, we started with the electric field pattern, the radiation pattern of the antenna. Radiation pattern can be divided into three: the field pattern, the power pattern, and the dB pattern. Okay. So whenever you plot the radiation pattern of the antenna, taking electric field as a reference, you call it as electric field pattern. Okay, and whenever as power pattern, and if system of power and plot it, it is the dB pattern. And again, you have seen how to represent the different parameters of the radiation pattern, namely the half power beamwidth, the beamwidth between personals, and so on. Then we slowly moved into the beam area of the antenna, which is the area over which the antenna is effectively radiating the power or useful power radiated by the antenna. So again, it was approximately equal to theta HP to pi HP. Okay, when you take the product of the half power beamwidths in the two principal planes, you get that. Then we came with the radiation intensity, which is the power radiated by the antenna per unit solid angle. Okay, then we saw how to express radiation intensity. So radiation intensity is given by R square into SR, that is equal to PT by 4 pi. Okay, power per unit solid angle. So then U of theta comma phi is the representation used for radiation intensity. So then we slowly moved into the other parameters, namely the gain and the directivity. So okay, directivity represents the focusing capability of the antenna. Okay, that means in which direction the antenna is radiating maximum power and in which direction the antenna is radiating minimum power. That is represented by directivity. So normally directivity is given by 4 pi by omega A, where omega A represents the smaller the beam area, a directivity of that. That means you are going to beam kind of an antenna, pencil beam kind of a radiation pattern, straight radiation, okay, without spreading. Then gain is defined by antenna efficiency to directivity. So antenna efficiency will be representing the losses inside the taking place inside the antenna structure. So normally its value will be always less than 1. So in that case, G will be always less than the directivity of the antenna. Okay. And also we talk about beam efficiency and stray factor. So beam efficiency represents the angular area over which the antenna is radiating useful power. It's the ratio of the useful power to the unwanted power. Okay, in terms of angular area, that is known as the beam efficiency. And stray factor represents the ratio of the power radiated in the undesired direction coming out to the total power, including the main lobes, the side lobes, and the back lobes. Okay, considering the angle as a reference again, so stray factor represents the power contained in the minor lobes and the back lobes and the side lobes. So the sum of the beam efficiency and stray factor will be always equal to 1. This is what we saw. And finally, we did support whatever the formula that we to give you about how to calculate the values. Yeah. So I thank you for your patient listening. In the next class, we'll look into some more parameters. Till then, thank you.